with education, such as is contained in this case and other places too, where there are good philosophies and teachings of moral conduct and all the rest, we will not send out thought forms of aggression. We will not allow ourselves to be stirred up into hate and blind, you know, anger and rage. We will not act those things out. We will think them through. We will struggle to come through a logical position. And this is not about pacifism, because they say every creature in creation has a means of defending itself, because there is always aggression. There's always attack. There's always a defense. Because in the dynamic, remember, we're talking about positive, negative, good, bad, light, dark, yin and yang, you need that for life to move, but there always must be a growth, a dynamic movement towards evolution and peacefulness, but that requires protection. So if people give up their means of self-defense, it's a spiritual crime. It's not only a right to defend yourself, it's a responsibility. If a person or a people discover that somehow they have bought into pacifism and we will always turn the other cheek, then we've misunderstood, because to allow yourself to be victimized is a spiritual crime. So it's very complicated. These people have weapons, they just don't attack with them, they defend with them. They loaned Meyer one of their antique beam weapons. He put a hole in a tree all the way through an apple tree. Oh, could he have drilled it? Not likely. Why not likely? Smooth as glass all the way through, everything in a straight line into the forest is singed. When the investigators go and measure, they say, well, that's a pretty good trick with a drill, you know, burned for as far as they could go. So they defend themselves, they protect themselves, because they're human beings, and it, no matter, as long as you're incarnate in some form, from a little microbe to a highly advanced human being, you have to be able to defend yourself. And that maintains their respect and, you know, necessary. But you don't go and aggress. For instance, the United States of America, my country, in the last 60 years, we have aggressed 200 plus times, well over 200 times, all unprovoked against other peoples and other countries that didn't attack us. The latest thing I just saw on the internet, I think it was the FBI went and assassinated a man in Puerto Rico. Now, he might have been a controversial fellow, but he was 72 years of age, sitting around with his wife, and he surrounded his place with a SWAT team and helicopters, shot him and let him bleed to death. Well, that's not exactly a good way to go. How dangerous was that man? Hadn't attacked anybody. These policies, what happens is we forget one of the primary teachings that actually appears in religions, usually, like, do unto others as you would have others do unto them, and that which a man soweth, so shall he reap. It simply means the laws of cause and effect. Take away any religious overtones. And it means if you push something out, when you throw something out, there is always an opposite and equal reaction. It comes back in its own time. We, in America, when we see things happening, be they natural disasters, attacks, anything else, we have to also look at the causative actions. Now, it doesn't mean that everything that happens to you, you've violated somebody or something. There's weather storms that happen and all the rest. But just like we've extracted all this petroleum and natural gas from the earth and upset the tectonic plate structure, which we were warned by the Pleiaron 30 years ago, this is going to lead to volcanic eruptions, earthquakes, tsunamis, floods, climate changes, you're burning down your forests, you're going to have catastrophes upon you in ever-increasing in frequency and intensity because of your ignorant action. So when you go out and you invade a country for so-called national interests, which aren't your business to do, sooner or later you pay the price. And if you look throughout history, there's always a leveling, one way or another, that pendulum comes back and cleans your clock.
That's a big responsibility, getting that message over.
Well, it's a law of physics. It shouldn't be so hard, but we don't teach this in school. We teach all sorts of mumbo-jumbo and either, hyper-religious or hyper-secular stuff that it doesn't accord with reality. Don't throw it out unless you, are willing to have it come back and hit you in the face. So if you're going to send out actions and thoughts, make them be the things that are preferred that you'd like to experience as well. So that way we create peace by treating people as we'd like to be treated. There will be people that will be irrational, there's no doubt. As far back as in the 50s, they told Meyer, there's going to be an upsurge of religious fundamentalism, craziness coming from many parties, and it's not exclusive only to Islam, but it is there. It's in Christianity, it's in Judaism, it's in Buddhism, and it's in Hinduism. It's in all of these forms that start to polarize so much, and they have the one truth, and they're going to kill you if you don't take it on. Well, you can't just sit back and let people roll over you, but you also, you don't invest in these people. You don't support them with your CIA and just try and direct them against somebody else, hoping they won't come towards you. Mm. It's complex. This is real life. There's no snapping of your fingers, but it's the, either we have the principles intact or we don't. Right now, we don't.
Yeah. And you personally, right, you've taken on a bit of a quite big task, getting that message out for Billy.
Well, I like it.
How does that impact on you? I mean, public reaction?
Well, as I say, the people that I've had the most trouble with have been the UFO researchers.
Sorry about that.
And the skeptics.
You're in Australia now, you should be okay.
Oh, well, I don't care, I don't mind. Because you see, it's okay. You know, because, look, I haven't gone through this. Billy's the guy that's gone through all this stuff. I'm a reporter. I'm a researcher. In a way, I don't take it personally. And if people are mad at me or at material, I think, well, let's deal with the question. Let's deal with the issue. Let's deal with the challenge. If you've got a good challenge, what you're going to make me do is work harder. If I work harder, I get in there to refine and find out, well, is it possibly wrong? Is there something I don't know? Or, oh my gosh, it's opening up even more stuff. And so when you come back to the skeptics, with this next layer of revelation that their own challenge has provoked, it's like they don't have enough fingers to stick in the dikes to plug the holes. You know, they're going, well, I'll stick my nose in it. You did. You stuck your nose in it. You know? So, in a way, I say to people, this is the easiest thing to do. Easy in the sense that it's there. It's not filled with lies that you have to keep. Billy doesn't have to sit there and go say, oh, what did I tell you last year? You know, oh, it's this. You ask him a question. If he doesn't know the answer, he says, I don't know. If he knows it, he tells you the answer. I tried to trick him as I was talking to you folks earlier. I tried to trick him with something I'd asked him a year ago. The answer was the same. Boom, just like that. And he's had quite a few conversations in a year, as we all have. He probably has had a few more. So you start to get a sense of a person's character and their truthfulness. Mm-hmm. And I consider it an honor to be able to simply report what I've found here. It's like, I don't consider myself some big cog in the deal. There's other people who could pick up the slack if I'm not doing this anymore. And there are people around the world now. I've had visitors from at least 80 countries to my website. And I've gotten emails from all over the world now, that people that now have the DVD or the different books or the videos and stuff. And I'm going, okay, well, the cat's out of the bag. You've uncorked the bottle. The genie's out there. Like that sound there. You know? So it's a done deal. Mm-hmm. And from here, it'll just be a...
Yep, excuse me a minute. Oh.
So really with disseminating the information, making it available to people, it's now it can't be stopped. Mm-hmm. It's a done deal. Mm-hmm. We may go through the changing times either dramatically and very, very painfully, or a little more elegantly, a little more gracefully. The more people that even hear about the case, you know, I'm representing this case, I'm not saying there aren't other contributing things, but the more people that hear about the Meier case and start to look, that realize that there's a peace meditation, probably one of the most important things in the entire case is what's known as the Salome peace meditation, an ancient, ancient, ancient meditation that's actually performed by not only some people here on the planet, but by 3.2 billion extraterrestrial humans on our behalf.
Yeah.
If we could get an expanded network of people on one weekend, 20 minutes, it's on my website, they can look and see how to do it, they can even get from Switzerland a DVD so you can hear how it's pronounced. We could make a quantum leap in peace, because what they've said is these are ancient, from the Lyran star system, ancient words that simply open the Akashic and help to dissolve some of the shroud of negativity around the planet from all these thought forms from thousands of years of negative thinking. And it's a Salome peace meditation. Salome Gamnan Ben Urda Ganiber Asala Esperona. It's kind of quick pronunciations, stretched out a little more than that. But this is done for 20 minutes.
Yeah.
And it's being done simultaneously, as I say, by these extraterrestrial humans on our behalf. But it can't work fully without more and more people participating here. Yeah. That put into motion is a huge thing that people can do if they sense that that's positive for them. Mm. Taking your peace symbol, remember your peace symbol from the 60s?
Yeah.
Turn it right side up. It's upside down. It is right now and has been for the past over 30 years. Literally, we've been walking around with the symbol of death. The Nero cross, the upside down, the root, it's a symbol of death and militarism. It's a sword with the branches going down and one thrusting thing. The peace symbol as it's meant to be, and that's shown on the website, it's a tree of life. Mm-hmm. You turn it upside down, and now you see those two elements that we're pointing down are open and up. Yeah. And it's an upward energy, openness, harmony, peace, life. And a simple mechanism like that, use it, turn your peace symbols upside down. Feel free to take it and put it on your stationery and start using that idea. And don't run out protesting for peace with a militant symbol. Embody that symbol, use the symbol, and don't go killing people with it, you know, beating them over the head with it. Yeah. It's not the way to do it. So a lot of this stuff I'm giving, you know, the Cliff Notes version of it, but it's in the case, and there's plenty there that gets right down to how societies need to structure, what's appropriate for immigration in worlds where you still have various countries and boundaries and borders, why we should dismantle every nuclear power plant, how toxic that is, the proper way to have rotations of births to limit population naturally so we don't have to have pestilence and disease and wars and we bring... You'd be so surprised. You go, well, where's the UFOs? Well, that's the ships they came in. You know, like in our country, you know, Columbus arrived offshore with three ships, the Nina, the Pinta, and the Santa Maria. Okay, great, we got the ships out of the way. Who are these guys and what are they here for?
Yeah. Right.
In this case, okay, well, it's very dazzling and fancy UFOs. Oh, extraterrestrials, how wonderful. Well, what are you here for? That's why when people talk about so-called contact cases and what they're photographing and filming, I say, I don't even care about UFOs because I can't do anything with UFOs. I've seen them. I've seen the best UFO photos and films in the world. Okay, now what? What's the content? What do they have to offer? What piece of the puzzle are they putting on the table for us to put in place? Mm. Not what are they going to do to set us straight. I don't want anybody coming to save me again because you're in trouble all over again. You know? Yeah. No, what's the piece of the puzzle here? They put that one down. We've got our own. Okay, now the picture starts to come into shape.
Yeah.
And that's, you know, very much what we're trying to do here. Yeah. It's not dramatic, it's slow. Leadership, not from the top down, from the bottom up.
Exactly.
One person at a time. Someone who starts to get this and discusses with those, not to teach and make people follow or get involved. If someone resonates, if they're interested and you're talking, you start to create that network, that hundredth monkey thing happens, the ripples in the pond, all the different stones are dropping. Now you've got these different interference patterns that are creating a web of strength in consciousness, and that will be the foundation upon which a new world, not a new world odor, but a new world gets built.
Yeah.
So we're leaving that idea behind.
Yeah.
And
we're beyond.
We're beyond that. And it's going to be very, you know, interesting the way
people
go about
times.
It. These are people, by the way, the extraterrestrials in my case have calluses in their hands. Mm-hmm. They work on their own land. Mm-hmm. Now, they're not dependent on that for their food. They have high, you know, agricultural, but these are people that have gotten back to the primary idea that you live somewhere and you work somewhere and you take care of life and you contribute to your society and your society contributes to you. They don't have politics anymore and they don't have money. They have high accountability. Their leaders are the most spiritually and philosophically wise people who also have to do their 2 hours of work every day on the planet. Yeah. So you don't have hierarchies. You don't have celebrities and they're not there to accumulate wealth. How many pieces of paper do you need if you have access to a craft in which you can leave the planet and travel through the cosmos, you can learn the most amazing things, you can interact with other give me green pieces of paper or anything. You know, Australian money is very beautiful. It really is. But I'll take the capacity to do all this stuff. The price.
I'll take the ride.
Wouldn't you take the ride?
Yeah.
But the price for the ride is to give up acquisitiveness and trying to accumulate the excessively unnecessary amounts of material goods.
You can have my camera then.
Okay,
start?
I've been waiting for
How
that.
Do we start?
That's what this was leading to, you know. I want that camera.
You want that camera? Yeah. So, oh, well, that's amazing.
And you know, they have to they have to conform to a certain order, but they have great freedom at the same time.
Yeah, and I don't doubt that tonight people will be very enlightened with your information. So
I will wear a protective suit.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Michael.